Thank you very much. I'm really delighted and surprised to be joining this distinguished panel. But Ed and Leslie asked me just to review a few of the basics about the economics of information, public goods, and publishing. And so I'm very pleased to be doing that. But the first thing I have to say is that these are just my personal perspectives and not necessarily those of the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. So you may have noticed that economists always like to talk about markets. Well, at least until recently they have. So why is that? That's because their story about competitive markets always has a happy ending. Firms maximize revenue. That's what they're supposed to do for their shareholders. And they do that in the classical theory by producing at a level where the price equals the marginal cost. That's the cost of producing an extra unit of whatever it is that they're making. Given a technology, competition adjusts the number of firms so that supply equals demand at that price that's supposed to equal the marginal cost. So prices tell you everything that you need so that everyone is happy, doing what they think best for themselves without having to think about anybody else. That's the story of the invisible hand. And it guides us to an equilibrium that has a glorious property called Pareto efficiency, which means that you can't make anyone better off without making someone else worse off. So it's that kind of not wasting. So it's a great story. What could go wrong? What could possibly go wrong with this? Now we know maybe lots, but yesterday Ed and Leslie asked me just to give a quick primer on those market failures associated with information technology and with publishing in particular. So how is an information good, like, say, an open access article on the web or a book on the web, how is that different from a traditional commodity like a loaf of bread? And what do we need to have a happy ending that efficiently benefits society if we're thinking about these kinds of information goods? So a loaf of bread is an example of a good that economists call rival. And what that means is that what I use of it diminishes the amount that anybody else can have. So if I eat the bread, that's it. And it's also excludable, and that means that it's easy for me to prevent other people from using once I bought it. But this is in contrast, say, to a good that you might think of like a lighthouse or a park or a new idea, because these are neither rival nor excludable. So they're called non-rival and non-excludable. And economists therefore call these public goods. So this is a kind of commodity that have these two properties. And the provision of public goods is a natural concern for governments and, I have to say, for private charities like the Sloan Foundation. And that's because in a free market, potential suppliers will find it hard to recover the costs of a public good and so will be produced at levels that are less than the social optimum. So if you go to your local venture capitalist and ask them to support you to build a lighthouse somewhere, you're probably not going to get very far. So information is generally considered non-rival. And unless the legal system comes into play, it's also non-excludable. So information as a commodity shares the characteristics of a public good. Now, Merton pointed out that for this reason, there would be very few incentives for producers to distribute new ideas at all, ever, if not for the system of rewarding priority that modern academia, in particular modern science, has instituted. And that also accounts for many of the winner-take-all kind of mores that we see in our profession. Other peculiar properties of information include, on the demand side, the fact that you really don't know what a given piece of information is worth until you possess it, and that the value also depends on its context, its use, its timing, and who else has that piece of information. On the supply side, information goods tend to have high fixed costs, but low or even zero incremental costs. For example, it can be very expensive to make the first recording of a new song, or the first dose of a new medicine, or the first copy of a new academic journal issue or a new book. But then the cost of making subsequent copies, is often negligible in comparison. And that's the key part from an economic point of view that the information technology revolution has really changed. That's exactly where this cost structure of high fixed costs but very low incremental costs, that comes in. And it's a natural concern then for regulators because it also inhibits competition. If several firms offer interchangeable goods, consumers will only buy the one with the lowest price. As firms bid down the price, the only floor is the incremental cost of production. But we just said that that could be very, very low. Because selling at that price will not cover the high fixed costs, producers will be forced out of business until just one of them remains. The single seller can then operate as a monopolist. In practice, what one often observes under such circumstances is monopolistic competition, in which there are a few somewhat different products in the market, some of which are close substitutes. So the automobile, the cell phone industries, maybe I don't have to remind this gathering that if you're in the business of selling operating systems for computers, that you might be in exactly that kind of a situation as well. These are all examples of monopolistic competition, and it's in contrast to the market, say, for wheat, where there are so many producers and so many buyers that people generally take prices rather than setting them. So what happens when it comes to providing public goods? What should we do about that? Well, it turns out behavioral economics is all the rage, so let's try an experiment. I want to play a little game with you. It's a social dilemma game. And all you have to do is decide whether you want to play strategy C or strategy D. Now we're going to count up how many people have chosen C and D. And let's imagine that the number of people who get Cs, who decide to be Cs, that anyone who's a D player gets that number of dollars. Okay, so if you're a D player, you are going to get a number of dollars, we're imagining, that's equal to the number of C players. If, on the other hand, you're a C player, you will get the number of dollars, which is the number of C players, minus 20. Okay? So think about that for a minute. And here's what I'd like you to do. Maybe I'll ask the panel to help me make a quick estimate of how many people vote each way. And we're going to do something that I learned as a professor. I want you to vote this way. Cover your eyes. I don't want to see whatever is going on. Cover your eyes, and how many people, everybody cover your eyes. Really. How many people want to play the C strategy? Okay, hands down. How many people want to play the D strategy? Very interesting. Okay, thank you. You say roughly half and half? I would say very rough.
More D's?
Okay.
Two-thirds D's.
Two-thirds D's? Okay. So maybe a few more D's. So let's see what happens now without voting with your eyes covered. Okay? So what we saw was that there were about two-thirds D's. So say there are 200 people here. So let's say half. So if it were half and half, if there are two-thirds, then everybody who is a C would get...
There's 300 people here.
300 people here?
And two-thirds were D's.
300 people here and two-thirds were D's. Okay, so that means that all the C's would get $100 and all the D's would get $80. Okay? Let's vote again now that you've seen how that works. What? Oh, the other way around. I'm sorry. No. Okay. Right. Okay. You understand what it's supposed to be. Okay. Let's vote again with your eyes open. How many people want to play C? Maybe fewer. And how many people want to play D? Ooh, lots more. Okay. So in this case, the C's are going to get even less, right? And the D's are also going to get less. Okay, what's going on here? The C's are generating the wealth, right? And the D's are exploiting that, right? So they're sort of, the C's are cooperating and the D's are defecting. If you want to think of this as a kind of a group prisoner's dilemma problem, if you want to think of it that way. Okay, what if you were a CEO of a company and you're responsible to your shareholders? Which way would you vote then? Probably most people would vote D. It would be very hard to justify voting C otherwise, right? But what is the Pareto efficient strategy in this situation? There's only one Pareto efficient strategy, and that would be for all of us to vote C, okay? And then we would all get a very a high amount of money. We'd have to sacrifice the $19 and stuff like that, but we would all get much more money than you guys were producing with your votes, eyes covered or not covered, right? So if we could somehow agree to do that, then we would all be better off by investing in C. So the kind of example I want you to think of is strategy C is like buying a membership in your local NPR station. Okay? And it's not an accident that the Sloan Foundation is concerned with supporting NPR and PBS and things like that. Or you could think of strategy C as posting your scholarly work on an open access site on the internet, and strategy D is going to a for-profit publisher. So think about exactly what's going on there, and the Pareto efficient outcome is for us to cooperate, to be C's, to contribute there to the public good. So in closing, the dismal science really doesn't automatically provide a happy ending in the case that we're each left to our own devices. What's different about this is we had to think about what other people in the room might be doing, and what we do affects what their outcomes are. So the economic analysis points to the need for government and for private foundations and for institutions that can engender trust and social capital, because if we all trusted each other to vote C, we would have all been much better off. So despite all the innovation and the other good things that profit-seeking companies can accomplish, we need to think beyond market forces alone if we want to achieve the potential that information technology has for promoting the public good. Thank you.